Hello there! As we have witnessed the somewhat successful landing of Starship SN10 and falling debris of SN11, we have also seen more and more pictures of what will eventually become the Starship's thermal protection system. This is crucial for the ultimate goal of rapid reusability, but Space Shuttle had the same goals and we all know how that went. Reusability turned into full refurbishment and quick turnaround became 5 months, 750,000 work hours and manual checkup of over 24,000 tiles. So what are the differences and improvements that SpaceX has in their sleeves to make the goal of full and rapid reusability into reality? This is what I want to talk about, but first, to comprehend the insane level of the challenge, we need to understand some basic physics. So let's dive straight into it, without burning up. Any spacecraft in orbit has a lot of kinetic energy because of how fast it's going. Let's consider a hypothetical example where Starship detaches from the International Space Station and heads down for landing. The speed of the ISS is 7.6 km per second, and we can optimistically assume that the Starship's mass with landing fuel is around 100 tons. Then the kinetic energy mv squared divided by 2 is 100,000 times 7,600 squared divided by 2, which equals to around 3 terajoules. We should also add the gravitational potential energy based on its altitude, but it would be 10 times smaller than the kinetic energy, so I will ignore it. So to land, the Starship somehow needs to get rid of 3 terajoules. That is equivalent to 700 tons of TNT, or 5% of the energy of Hiroshima's nuclear explosion. If we assume the same flight profile as the Space Shuttle, which the Starship will not have because it does not have wings, the re-entry procedure from hitting the atmosphere to landing would last 30 minutes. Power equals work divided by time, so 3 terajoules uniformly distributed over 30 minutes will result in 1.7 gigawatts of power. With this, we could continuously power a DeLorean in order to go back to the past and prevent me from writing this terrible example into the script. Anyway, such a huge amount of energy needs to be somehow removed, and the only realistic way how to do this without burning additional fuel is to hit the atmosphere and convert the kinetic energy into heat. The problem is that 3 terajoules is so much energy that if it was just instantly converted to heat within Starship, it would raise its temperature by 64,000 degrees Celsius. And the stainless steel melts at 1450 degrees Celsius. But fortunately, there are better ways of dissipating the heat once we realize what is actually happening when a re-entering spacecraft interacts with the atmosphere. The spacecraft is moving so fast that the air in front of it cannot get out of the way quickly enough and gets compressed. Let's look at ideal gas law for simplicity, even though it cannot be realistically used in this scenario. It states that PV equals nRT, meaning that the pressure times volume is equal to the amount of gas times a constant times the temperature. So as the gas gets compressed, its pressure increases and therefore its temperature has to increase. This shock layer gets compressed so much during the re-entry that its temperature can reach tens of thousands of degrees. If that shockwave touches the spacecraft, it is really bad news for everyone involved. It's crucial to keep the shockwave as far as possible. Enter 1951, when two engineers, Allen and Eggers Jr., working for NASA's predecessor NACA, discovered something counterintuitive. They found out that blunt shapes are the most effective in dealing with the re-entry heat. More specifically, that the heat load was inversely proportional to the drag coefficient. If the re-entry vehicle is made blunt, air cannot get out of the way quickly enough and becomes an air cushion that pushes the shockwave away from the vehicle. This greatly reduces the heat load. A shockwave that is not touching the vehicle is called a detached shockwave, while the conical shape has an attached shockwave. And this is the first main advantage of the Starship over the Space Shuttle. Its perfectly round cylindrical shape will increase the distance from the shockwave, with the exception of the control surfaces. That being said, the layer between the shockwave and the vehicle is still thousands of degrees hot, and it happily heats up the spacecraft by contact, while the shockwave itself is heating it up by radiation. With higher re-entry speeds, for example from interplanetary missions, The thermal radiation becomes the main heating source because there is more compression from speed, therefore higher gas temperature and the radiated energy increases with the power of 4 of the temperature. Having the high drag coefficient not only makes the re-entry theoretically survivable by detaching the shockwave, but also, obviously, slows down the vehicle. An important strategy for surviving the re-entry is to slow down in high altitude as much as possible before hitting the denser levels of atmosphere below. It not only allows to spread the heat more uniformly over larger amounts of time, but also reduces the peak acceleration for the crew, making it more comfortable. To manage its deceleration and heat dissipation, the spacecraft needs to control its angle of attack. For that, Starship has its control surfaces, so-called elonerons, and will even produce some lift at its 60-degree angle of attack. This is nothing new. Space Shuttle used its wings, and even the standard Apollo-style capsules have control over their angle of attack by moving the off-axis center of gravity. But what if we are designing a re-entry vehicle for a ballistic missile? Those need to descend through the atmosphere as quickly as possible to avoid being intercepted. We all face this problem every day. We would need something pointy that has low aerodynamic drag at hypersonic speeds. That's why the shape of the modern warhead resembles the conical shape on the right. Its low aerodynamic drag results not only in high speed, but also a very close proximity to the shockwave. So, how does its heat shield survive the extreme temperatures of the shockwave? Well, it doesn't. The ballistic missiles use a specific type of a heat shield called ablative heat shield. The outer layer of the heat shield gets extremely hot, up to 11,000 degrees Celsius. This ablative heat shield has a unique way of stopping the heat transfer to the inner layers of the heat shield and to the spacecraft. When it gets really hot, the resin that keeps it together vaporizes, and the hot outer layer flakes away from the aircraft, carrying the accumulated heat with it. The ablative heat shield is so powerful that it has been chosen by NASA for its Stardust spacecraft. Its goal was to return comet samples back to Earth for further study, but to do that, the vehicle had to survive re-entry at 13 km per second, which is still a record for the fastest re-entry of a human-made object. The material they developed for this mission is called phenolic impregnated carbon ablator, or PICA for short. When SpaceX needed to decide the heat shield for their Dragon spacecraft, they decided to develop an improved version of PICA, which was 10 times cheaper, slightly better, and called it PICA-X. It is working so well that its third version is now used on the Crew Dragon, returning American astronauts and soon paying tourists safely back to Earth. But having to rebuild the heat shield after every mission clashes with Starship's primary goal, which is full and rapid reusability. So if ablative shielding is not an option, the only other viable choice is so-called heatsink. The heat shield in form of the tiles, similar to what was used on the Space Shuttle. The heatsink type of thermal protection relies on ability to absorb the heat and prevent the heat reaching the spacecraft. So the crucial properties are very low thermal conductivity and high specific heat capacity and melting point. Elon mentioned that the tiles are made out of silicon and aluminum oxide, possibly with some carbon in it. They're also black, so they might be using similar black glazed borosilicate coating, which gives it the black color. That means that they're an evolution of the Space Shuttle tiles, which are capable of withstanding 1260 degrees Celsius. These tiles are like a hard foam, with 90% of the volume being air and 10% silica. If you are interested in some math showing the amazing capabilities of these tiles in numbers and its comparison to other common materials, I will go through it at the end of this video. So, if Starship is using the same composition for its tiles as Space Shuttle, will it experience the same sort of problems as Space Shuttle did? Not necessarily. Starship has several key advantages, but first, let's look at some of the major problems of the Space Shuttle's thermal protection system. Ice and insulation falling off the main tank in flight, hitting the orbiter's fragile tiles at high speeds. Complex shape of the orbiter body, resulting in most of the tile shapes and sizes being unique, making manufacturing, quality control and refurbishing time for 24,000 tiles a nightmare. A problematic adhesive bonding method for attaching the tiles that caused a lot of them to fall off before or during the re-entry. And the airframe is made from aluminum, which has a melting point of 500 degrees Celsius and loses strength way before that. Let's see if these issues translate to the current Starship design. The problem of falling ice and insulation from the main tank obviously doesn't apply for Starship. There is no main tank or any other object in front of the Starship. Compared to the Space Shuttle, the Starship is mostly just a cylinder. As obvious this statement is, the consequences are extremely important. This shape allows SpaceX to have the majority of the Starship covered by tiles with identical shapes and sizes. This makes everything simpler, quicker, cheaper, and more reliable because both placement and quality control can be automated. And speaking of automation, one of the recent videos from NASA spaceflight captured this very interesting procedure of a very large Starship segment rotating turntable style, covered in white insulation fabric. So we can safely assume that SpaceX is making progress with the design and robotic placement of spot-welded expansion joints, which the thermal tiles snap onto. It's pretty much stud welding, possibly with special studs. And these robots, delivered over half a year ago, are doing the work. There's a need for expansion joints because, when heated during re-entry, the tiles will expand at different rates than the steel it's mounted to. So there must be some gaps and ability to expand without breaking the tiles. These joints have the same purpose as the Space Shuttle's adhesives, and if SpaceX can make the system to survive launch vibrations and re-entry, the manufacturing process would suddenly become very fast and efficient. And finally, the last weakness of the Space Shuttle's thermal protection system was its aluminum frame. Every time when a tile was lost, there was a serious danger of the re-entry heat reaching the aluminum frame and melting structural parts. It takes around 500 degrees C to melt aluminum, but it loses a significant part of its strength already at 250 C. And here, the stainless steel Starship's body really makes a difference, and in more ways than one. While the melting point of aluminum is around 500 degrees Celsius, the 304L stainless steel melts at around 1400 degrees Celsius, and its service temperature that it can safely and repeatedly operate under is 800 degrees Celsius, even though it loses most of its strength. But the service temperature is still greater than the limit of 650 degrees Celsius of the Space Shuttle's white tiles that cover the central part of the orbiter. That means that SpaceX really might get away with not covering the leeward side of the Starship, or without the need to paint it white like its lunar version. By the way, if you're curious about why is the lunar Starship white, I have you covered in my previous video. Anyway, when the stainless steel shell is allowed to get really hot, it can also radiate away heat quicker, with the power of 4th to be specific. Stainless steel at its melting point will radiate away heat 22 times faster than aluminum at its melting point. SpaceX really seems to be onto something here, one by one removing all the fundamental flaws of the Space Shuttle's thermal protection system and replacing them with simpler solutions, from stud-welded expansion joints to symmetrically shaped interchangeable tiles. Even if they will not change the tile chemistry, they might be able to achieve their goals. Also, the short control surfaces compared to the Space Shuttle's wings might make it easier, because when partially folded, like in this render, they might be away from the shockwave. But similar to the Space Shuttle, they will probably still have to put special reinforced carbon-carbon tiles on their control surfaces. These tiles have better thermal properties than the usual tiles, but are much heavier, so NASA used them only on the nose cone and leading edges of the wings. Now, let's talk in detail about the incredible properties of the Space Shuttle's high-temperature reusable insulation tiles, or HRSI for short, which covered the whole underbody. As mentioned before, a good thermal shield has to have high specific heat capacity and low thermal conductivity and be able to withstand high temperature. When we compare materials in this table, we can see that the lightest substance is air, which also has the lowest thermal conductivity and highest specific heat. The perfect insulator. But the problem is that to use it, it has to be trapped. And that is exactly what the Space Shuttle tiles, which are 90% air, are doing. They are also extremely light, with only slightly higher thermal conductivity. The metals with the highest thermal conductivity are copper and aluminum, which is also why they are commonly used as heatsink materials. The highlighted numbers will be used in the following examples. Since the Starship is made out of stainless steel, we can do a back-of-a-napkin math to see what would happen if we replace the thermal tiles with additional layer of stainless steel that would have the same weight as the tiles. In our hypothetical scenario, the temperature of the surface of the tile is 1260 degrees Celsius, and the temperature of the Starship's hull is 80 degrees Celsius. Assuming that the thickness of the thermal tile is 100 millimeters, since stainless steel's density is 55 times higher, the equivalent heavy layer of stainless steel would be only 1.8 millimeters thick. The thermal conductivity is 0.126 watts per meter Kelvin for the thermal tile and around 29 for 304L stainless steel. Now, if we want to know how much heat would transfer onto the Starship's hull, we need to look at the heat flux. The one-dimensional heat flux is computed as k times derivative of t with respect to x. In our simple example, the derivative of t with respect to x simply means difference in temperature in the material per unit thickness. So the heat flux is computed as a thermal conductivity k times surface temperature minus hull temperature divided by the thickness of the material x. For thermal tile, we can write this as 0.126 times 1180 degrees divided by 0.1 meters, which results in 1.5 kilowatts per square meter. If we plug in the numbers for stainless steel, we get 29 times 1180 divided by 0.0018, which results in 19 megawatts per square meter. So, if the tiles were replaced by stainless steel, our back-of-a-napkin math would suggest that the amount of heat transferred onto the Starship's hull would be more than 12,000 times larger. Now, this seems like a pretty good reason to keep the tiles. What's even more interesting about the thermal tiles at their maximum temperature of 1260 degrees is the comparison between the heat transferred into the spacecraft structure versus the heat radiated away. We have already computed the former at 1.5 kilowatts, so let's compute the latter. The thermal radiation is computed as the material's emissivity parameter times Stefan-Boltzmann constant times area times temperature to the power of 4th. The tiles have a special borosilicate coating, which not only gives the tiles their black color, but also high emissivity of 0.85. After we plug in the numbers, we get 0.85 times 5.67 times 10 to the power of minus 8 times 1 square meter times 1260 plus 273.15 kelvins to the power of 4th, which equals to 266 kilowatts per square meter. This means that at its maximum temperature, the tile radiates 180 times more heat away from the spacecraft than they transfer onto the spacecraft. So the tiles not only soak up the heat, prevent its heat transfer onto the structural elements, but also remove a large majority of the heat away, and all that while being extremely light. This is all from me today, and I hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, please subscribe and go to see my other videos with spaceflight explained, for example, micrometeorites and orbital debris or space radiation. You have a wonderful day!